Tonight's telecast of the 1989 Sports Star of the Year Awards is brought to you by Caltex Oil Australia. Nine Sports takes you live to the Hilton International Adelaide, where over 300 invited sporting celebrities are gathered to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the 1989 South Australian Sports Star of the Year Awards. Your compere for this evening, Tony Charlton.
Good evening, Adelaide. Good evening, South Australia. Mr. Premier, ladies and gentlemen, a significant milestone in sport's classic event. When today things seem to change so readily, it's good to feel secure with trusted friends. And so, Caltex and the news present their 25th anniversary sports star, wherein the champions of yesteryear get with the champions of today and they celebrate. And the group includes three times winners in Letha Martin and Vicky Cardwell, and our guest of honour, Ian Chappell. Well, I think that Martin would be very pleased with that reception, and no doubt Greg too.
Well, I guess Martin's up there looking down somewhere. Yeah, I hope he is. I hope he's having a beer, enjoying himself.
Can you tell me where this was?
This is Adelaide, mate, I can tell you that. Red Caps, that's got to be about 75, 76.
And here we are within, a couple of sixes of the Victor Richardson gates.
Yeah, he's probably up there with Martin, having a cold beer. They've got any sense, they are.
What influence was he on your career?
Vic, I think he told me about three things. He said, if you can't be a good cricketer, at least you can dress like one. I can't remember what the second one was. The third one was, if you ever get the opportunity to captain Australia, and he died before I captained Australia, he said, if you ever get the opportunity, don't captain it like a Victorian. Judging by that round of applause, I didn't captain it like a Victorian. I hope I captain it like a South Australian.
I was reading Jack Fingleton's Cricket Crisis. You'd know of it. One of the classics in the litany of works on cricket. And he was waxing eloquently about the Wanderers. And then I heard the great man say that there was nothing really like the Adelaide Oval.
Well, I would have thought that the only other ground that I've played on that comes near the Adelaide Oval is Cape Town, Newlands. Newlands is a very fine ground, but I think since they put the new stand at the Adelaide Oval, if there was any doubt about the most beautiful cricket ground in the world, I think they've solved that problem with the new stand. I think it's a magnificent addition. It's a great combination of keeping something that looks old, but it provides all the facilities that you need for a modern cricket ground. And I don't think there's a prettier cricket ground. And it's also got a damn fine wicket, which is good when you're a batsman.
Yes. Now, you've been witness to probably the most revolutionary period in the game's history. With what reservations do you look back on it? With what reservations do you look into the crystal ball?
Well, I think there are a lot of good things that came out of World Series cricket. Obviously, night cricket, I think, is probably the most important one. I think that's been an important development in the game of cricket. I think, as far as the future is concerned, well, I enjoy watching cricket. I've never had a day of watching cricket since I finished playing where I've been bored. Got pretty close to it today for a while, but you can all, if you look at the game in a positive way, you can always find something that's good. And for instance, I go along to the SCG. Unfortunately, he's not playing, but to see young Darren Lehman. You want to see a young star You want to be there when he plays his first game. It's nice to see them when they start out, and then you look at them in 10 years' time if they've gone on to be something. It's nice to be able to say, well, I was there when he played his first game. So there's always something interesting to look at in the game, and I enjoy every moment of it.
I was running a sports show in Victoria at a time when the communications was such that we had to have aeroplanes picking up the signal over Nil to relay it on into Melbourne.
Don Bradman always been a bit backward over there in Victoria.
And when you were selected for your first Australian appearance, we had a special rush trip done, and over the tape came on the plane, and we showed it to Victorians on the Sunday. Things have changed quite a deal, haven't they?
Yeah, and they're not so interested in anything outside their borders now.
I don't think we're going to get far with this. Did you ever envisage a career in commentary?
Well, I guess, obviously with Vic having been very interested in commentary, and the fact that the thing that I can remember was always rushing around the backyard playing cricket or football, and I always commentated the games when I played, so I guess I must have known something back there. There must have been something up there working. Not very often, I don't think, but it must have worked a little bit.
Well, you must feel, being in your home city, how pleased we are that you're back for this significant occasion in sport. We are delighted you're our guest of honour, and we ask you to do the honours for the others who step on the rostrum as of now.
Thank you very much for the invitation. It is nice to be back.
Multiple award winner, and one of three test cricketers to win the Sports Star over the years, Ian Chappell. Caltex and the news are just delighted, and so am I, that the men who are at the helm from the start of a great sporting tradition, are with us in this room tonight. First compere, Gordon Swartz. First organiser, Bob Rowan. Where are you, Bob? And first cameraman, Des Flavel. Regrettably not here tonight, the first winner, whose courage and fight for life even outshone his remarkable sporting ability. Of course, I'm speaking of Neil Hawke.
My heart would just come back to me. At the moment, I'd certainly feel very much more settled and feel that I had words adequate to say thanks for this great honour that has just been bestowed upon me. This is an honour. It is a wonderful thing. And I know that for each and every one that is before us, this has become a new award that we shall each look forward to each month, and then eventually at a function like this.
Knows about it, and so too do his daughters, Janet, Debbie, and Natalie, and an angel called Beverly. May Neil rest easily and recover surely. And the wind, I think, is beneath the wings of the stars of today, and we'll be meeting them next in the Caltex and the News Sports Star of the Year.
You are the wind.
The Sports Star of the Year for 1978, David Hooks.
On behalf of the other three or other living finalists, I'd like to say I'm very proud to be up here at the moment.
We're at the Adelaide Hilton for the Sports Star, and Hooksy, we'll see him again soon. The 25th anniversary Sports Star commences its salute to the champions who've made the final from the year just concluded. The Test spinner, who was named Sheffield Shield Player of the Year for season 88-89, Tim May. Tim was awarded a total of 18 points, two ahead of Queensland's Peter Cantrell, and three up on David Hooks and Greg Ritchie. 43 shield wickets and an average of 30.25. That's just terrific stuff.
Thanks, Sam.
Best performance for South Australia since when?
I don't know the answer to that. I imagine a few years, but not too long.
I imagine many, many years. And the best performance of seven against Victoria, and probably like all of good performances, when you're on a roll, it could have been better.
Yeah, they always can be better. They're 10 wickets to get, and they only got seven, so it's disappointing.
The Ashes tour and a spate of fateful injuries, not only there, but afterwards in India.
Yeah, that's a bit of a disappointment. I finished up last year, the 88-89 season, on a high and had high hopes over in England, and sort of the wheels started to fall off, a few hamstring injuries and then my knee injury, and so it's been disappointing since then.
Yeah, good for your character, but a hard lesson. Now, nothing else can go wrong, so what's next? The Shield final?
Yeah, that's the main priority. We're second on the table at the moment, and we've got three Shield games left, and you know, with a bit of luck, we can get three outrights or two outrights, you know, at least over the next couple of games, which should get us into the final, and I think this year we'll probably pull it off.
Just quickly, the Ashes triumph, great, but say we had to face up to the West Indies tomorrow.
Well, it's a different kettle of fish playing the Windies to England. England were in a state of disarray last year, but still, you know, we played them, we had to play them, and we won easily. Playing against the Windies is a different thing altogether, and I think at the moment the lads are pretty confident, and confidence is 95% of the game, and I think, you know, given them and their conditions over there, I think we'll do pretty well.
Our first sports star for the 1989 year, Tim May. Thank you, Tim. And now a turbocharged teenager who outclassed the superpowers of track and field with a brilliant 400 metres sprint during the Adelaide Games, Tanya Van Heer. Later at the national track titles, Tanya won gold in the under 20, 200 and 400 metre sprints. Her efforts were rewarded when she was named in the World Cup team for Barcelona. Will Barcelona be good for the Games?
Yep, very good.
Very good.
Yep.
I met Andres Gemino, who of course played a Wimbledon final and I think was a finalist in an Australian Open, and he said that Barcelona will stage the best games of all time. What was your first big international? That must have been it before Auckland.
Yep, Barcelona was. The World Cup was a big one.
Fantastic experience for you.
Oh yes, I was dying of nerves.
And I think you might be doing that now too.
Yep.
Yeah. A hamstring upset in the Perth trials. Terrible disappointment.
Yeah, I guess that comes with athletics. You get it up spots here and there. I guess you can't always have a good turn.
Were you pleased about the 4 by 100 relay result in Auckland?
Yes, it was very good actually.
Well, you would have been in that team.
Yeah, well, next time maybe.
Well, next time. There are going to be lots of next times. Can you successfully defend your national titles?
Well, if... The way I'm going at the moment, if I get my increase my speed, which John Daly reckons I will.
John Daly thinks
you will.
I have
a lot of faith in him. I think I will. I want to.
I've got a feeling she will. Congratulations, Tanya, and continue good wishes.
Thank you.
Tanya Van Heer. That tennis whiz who served notice of his 1989 intentions with a second successive South Australian Open, of course, Mark Woodford. And then at the US Open in Flushing Meadow, he won his first Grand Slam event, partnered with the volatile John McEnroe. He won the men's doubles, beating Olympic champions Flack and Seguso. Well, have you and Gabriella Sabatini been walking under ladders or something?
Yeah, we did the same injury and... We're actually in the same hospital, so it was pretty neat, I guess.
Yeah. There are worse things you could do than be in hospital with Gabriella, right?
That's it.
The rebound ace and the heat of the tournament. Some were saying that it had a sort of vulcanising effect, shoes on the surface. Would you agree with that? And if so, could it have been part and parcel of your accident?
I don't think it. I think it was just probably coincidental that it happened. You know, we've been playing at Flinders Park there for a couple of years now, and there have been no accidents whatsoever. And it was just... You know, I guess the day that I did it, and the same with Sabatini, it was pretty hot, and the court definitely does become rubberized, but you know, I think for me it was just my own clumsy feet, you know, under the pressure of running to a ball, and perhaps I should have given up on the ball rather than, you know, try and chase it down because it was pretty far away. But, you know, I had just had to go after it. And
the Davis Cup triumph against France, in which you should have figured.
Yeah, that was great. I was really pleased for Wally, you know, doing so well, winning both his singles. And, you know, I'm sure Darren got a lot of experience from playing there and learning. And it was just really difficult having to sit at home. And you know, it's easier on the sidelines and picking out all the mistakes. But hopefully, maybe the next round or the semi-finals, I can get back.
And has Wally emerged from the shadows? 2 5-setters in the Davis Cup, both of which he won. And immediately following, a 5-setter, which was an epic match against Verlander. In the early hours of the morning in Melbourne.
Yeah, I think Wally's been working pretty hard, you know, of late, and you know, I think he made a lot of people stand up and take notice that he was, you know, coming good, and it was fantastic for him. I think you know, a lot of people have probably, you know, don't know how, you know, he's such a good player, and it's just fantastic. I was really ecstatic for him.
And grass still seems to be our surface.
I think it's like a secret weapon for us. It's nice to have our major championships on a different surface, and I think you know, when we do play on, you know, in Davis Cup circumstances, if we can, you know, bring back the grass, I think it's like a weapon for us because we all know how to play on that.
Well, you know how to play Wimbledon, really, I suppose, will be your next thing. I hope you match fit enough because you're going to miss the French, aren't you?
Yeah, well, I would like to be back for the French, and I have to go to Melbourne on the weekend to do some work. Johnny Cosmina thinks you know, I'm a bit thin and need to build myself up a little bit. So I'll be trying to do that and you know, just see how it goes once my cast comes off, and then I can really make a point of where I can start.
Speedy recovery, young man, and good wishes. Mark Woodford.
Thank you.
And as he leaves us, look who's here. First footballer to win the Caltechs and first full forward to win the McGarry. 137 goals in 1969, Fred Phillis. Lovely to see you, Fred.
Thank you, Tony.
Oh, you were going to say something.
It's been a long time. I guess 2 decades is a long time ago, and I remember calling you Mr. Charlton in those days.
Oh, thanks. Would you prefer to be playing in the 90s, Fred?
I don't think so. I think there's a lot of character in the days I played. I never thought I'd say that, but there seemed to be. It's a lot more technical, maybe, and streamlined, and I was very happy playing that those times, and I think the character showed through more than it did now.
Should South Australia join the AFL?
I don't think so.
Max Bashir agrees.
I think there's... I have probably two thoughts in mind. I do run a business, and I don't see that sharing maybe a $50 million deficit with the other states is an even situation for us to bear. And I think that we've got a fairly strong competition here, and you know, I wouldn't like to see our clubs denigrated, you know, the competition we've got.
Fred Phillis and all the champions are here in the Caltech. Thank you. What star of the year? Sports Star of the Year, NWS 9 Adelaide, SES 8 Mount Gambier, and RTS 5A Loxton. Good evening to the Caltech's Chairman's representative, Peter Maceman, and to Roger Holden, Managing Editor and Chairman of the News, and your guests as the great parade continues here at the Adelaide Hilton. A Commonwealth gold and Olympic silver medalist who continued on her road to success by winning her third Great North Road race in England, here she is, Lisa Martin. Crowning glory, another Commonwealth gold medal. Congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Just fantastic, wasn't it? Now, Dad felt that Seoul was the greater performance, but Mum says that Auckland was.
I'm not sure which one was. They're pretty close. I was amazed at how fast I managed to run in Auckland, and I really enjoyed the race, so I wouldn't like to choose.
Amazed because you were out in front and were doing it on your own?
It's very hard that way, especially when it gets windy, which it did towards the end, but just to concentrate for that long is terribly hard, so I was really pleased with it.
Did Yoba's misfortune in the 5K upset you?
Oh, that was after my race, just as well, because if it was before, I think it might have, but that's all part of sport, and it was just a misfortune.
I think he was too tired watching you in the marathon.
Well, he got in some trouble because I told him to stay in bed the morning of my race and watch it on TV. It was 7 in the morning, and I think I'd only been running for about 6 minutes, and lo and behold, there's Jovis out in the course, and I told him to get back to bed. So I didn't see him after that. I was looking for him, and he wasn't around. I kept thinking, good, I think he's back in bed.
You'll be married on February 10th.
Mm-hmm.
And where are you going to settle? In Phoenix, in Australia, in Kenya, where?
We have a house in Phoenix, and he is building a house in Kenya, and he trained in Canberra for 2 months and loved Australia. So I hope that eventually we'll have a home in Kenya and one in Australia and spend time in both countries.
Are we giving away any family secrets in saying that we understand the romance started when you did some research on the Kenyan runners so that you could fit yourself for commentary on the Seoul Marathon?
Not quite, but no, I've always enjoyed being around the Kenyans. They're a lot of fun, so, yeah.
And the Auckland Games. The Obus isn't going to sleep, is he?
Wish you could crawl under a rock.
And the Auckland gold medal, tell us about that.
Auckland to me meant so much more than Edinburgh because I think the games are a lot nicer. We had no boycotts, and to get a second gold medal is so much nicer than to get the first because it seems so impossible. I really enjoyed it.
Magnificent run. Now, Ingrid Christensen could not break 2:20, can you?
I haven't set it as a goal. I think I can run a lot faster than I have run. My three fastest marathons have been in all women's races, and you always run faster in a mixed race where you've got people to pull you along. I think maybe because I haven't set it as a goal, maybe I'll do it. So, but I don't want to think about it. So if it happens, it will be nice. But I just go in races to be competitive and to try and win.
Yeah. Hey, the Rexandra ad's great.
Oh, thank you. I'm hoping they'll roll it over for another year.
Well, they will. How could they not? Well, with a flair for dress and presentation and arduous competition, dual gold medal winner at the Commonwealth Games, Lisa Martin.
Thank you.
The contenders for the category of sports star continue to be on show. A swim star who continued his National Open Championship form at the Australian Age Championships and is represented tonight by his coach, Graham Sampson, Philip Rogers. Philip won the 100 and 200 metres breaststroke competing in those age championships, then in the open titles in Melbourne, polished off 3 medals in a big haul. And since then, of course, what's he done, Graham?
Well, Philip's certainly come of age, I think, since those age championships. He made the Pan Pacific team to tour Japan in August, and there he performed very creditably. And, of course, he's made the Commonwealth Games team, which is so successfully competed in Auckland, and there he turned in his very best times.
And the team versus the coach in Auckland, overstated or not?
Well, I think we should be really bathing in the glory of the team successes in Auckland. We've read in the press, of course, there is some speculation of some problems, but I think if there are, they'll be resolved amicably between the coach, the swimmers and the
Do you find the youngsters less inclined to accept discipline from coaches today?
Well, swimming's a very disciplined sport, as I'm sure most of the people here would appreciate, and I feel that they're in tune with what has to happen at that level.
And now young Philip has already gone from Auckland to Europe.
He certainly is, and this weekend he'll be swimming in Bonn, I believe, so we're looking forward to his performances there, as well as his performances in the World Championships in Perth in 1991.
Philip Rogers was represented by his coach, Graham Sampson. Thank you, Graham.
Thank you.
A couple of years ago, Caltex introduced the Junior Award, the Pathfinder Award, and this time the outstanding youngsters nominated were Brett Maher in basketball, Karen Trenebring of netball, Brendan Bowden, a wheelchair athlete, and earlier tonight in this marvellous gathering at the Adelaide Hilton, we announced that Brett Maher of basketball was the winner. We ask him to stand as Kerry O'Brien, chairman of the judging panel, salutes him. Stand up there, Brett. Congratulations, Brett. And now we return to the big boys, whom I'm positive you will join sooner than later. Adelaide 36's power forward, who won the All-Star selection in the National Basketball League for the fourth year in succession, of course, Mark Davis. NBA Most Valuable Player in 1987, Mark led the Sixers with 25.4 points per game. and he was sensational in the final series in Perth, scoring a game high of 34 points in the decider. And you rewrote the basketball record books, they tell me, by becoming the first man to win the Woollacott medal four times.
Yeah, I was pretty happy with that. You know, you might not you might not believe it, but I was tickled pink.
Yeah. I like that. Yeah. You polled a record number of first preference votes, 18 votes in total, 14 first preference.
Yeah, I was pretty shocked that the voting really was really as lopsided as it was, because there was a few different ball players that had some pretty good, had a pretty good season. And I didn't think that I'd pull that high. But as it went and everything, I was pretty happy with it. So,
being the single biggest force in basketball here, you're entitled to tell us where you think we are on the progress scale.
Well, probably rating on, compared to America, where I'm actually coming from, probably on a scale from 1 to 10, I probably would rate it maybe about a 7.5 or 8.
And
it's getting pretty close.
How long to get to 10?
At the rate that it's going, because basketball is growing pretty quick here in this country, I'd say we've probably been another 3 to 5 years.
And the single most important thing that you say we've got to do?
Well, I think it's the attitude as Australian players. Their attitude has really, they shot for higher goals now than what they were before, when the basketball wasn't really all that big here. Now they're shooting for the moon. So even if they miss, they still be amongst the stars, so.
Aim for the stars and soar with the eagles. Thank you, Mark. And of the championship breed, the world record steeplechaser of 1970, who also broke the world indoor 2-mile record by a massive 8 seconds, say good evening to Kerry O'Brien. How do the times compare today, Kerry?
A lot sharper, I'm afraid, Tony.
Yeah, but you've been witness to a marvellous era in sport, haven't you? And our athletes, I think, are improving quite noticeably in the last 3 years.
Yeah, tremendous, really. I'm sure the Institute of Sport and the Australians getting behind their athletes has been a great thing.
Lovely to have you here. More great names in sport when Caltex and the News welcome you back to the Adelaide Hilton for the Caltex News Sports Star of the Year.
The Sports Star of the Year is John Cosmina.
John Cosmina and all the stars are here tonight, all right. I commend the first-class organisation of this event over the years and the kindly enabled Caltex men entrusted with it for the last 7 editions. And this 25th edition is his farewell. Ron Pannell, take a bow. Now the sports cavalcade continues. This South Australian skipper and his yachting produced a sensational win in the inaugural Lexan Cup in a thrilling finish. Chris Tillett. Chris Tillett sailed superbly in the 7-race regatta, but had to come from behind in the final heat for South Australia's most significant yachting victory. And in pilot's language, if I can, how many craft are you endorsed on?
Well, Tony, I've been sailing the past year 3 principal classes, but it's really like a lot of different sports. You know, you go out for a sail in whatever classes you enjoy.
Yeah, but they've got all different characteristics. I think it's a wonder how you handle them all. Anyhow, Olympic trialling already in the 470 class.
Yes, our aim is from Barcelona in 92. So, yes, the training has commenced, and we've got 2 years of pretty hard training.
Most unfortunate controversy, your exclusion in 88 after being a good representative in 84. Are you over that?
Oh, I don't think you ever get over that. It was extremely disappointing, but it does make you really want to put a maximum effort in next time and hopefully get there and score a medal.
You've already told us you're doing that now, and they tell me you're different in your approach to yachting than others. Explain that.
Oh, I don't know who's told you that.
You work differently.
We certainly try to be very thorough in the approach, and the one thing I've been very fortunate in is always being able to select very good crews because the boats I do sail are a team boat, and I've been very fortunate in that respect.
Good luck for 92, that's what we're saying. Chris Tillett, thank you very much. And now our winner of 1987 with a big chance again. Well, he's overseas. In the 1989 year under review, the squash supremo came within a whisker of winning the world title. Represented by Alan Dittmar, his father, it is, of course, Chris Dittmar. Get through to the final. Chris beat 6 times world champion and 8-time British Open winner Jahanga Khan. And in the final, former world champion Jancha Khan battled back from 2 sets down to Chris to overcome him and win in 5 sets. And then your boy captained the Australian contingent to a world team final in Singapore.
That's right, Tony, yes.
That was a big effort. And did he beat Jahanga twice within a few days?
Yes, he did, twice within 10 days, yes.
The first two times he'd beaten him?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, fantastic.
Yeah.
Now, another knee operation, I didn't like hearing about that, and I liked it less when they tell me that they took out 100 pieces of bone fragment.
Yes, that's right. Yes, didn't do much for us either. No, that's right.
But the fact is, he's back into it, and the top 8 in the world are over there in Canada again now.
Yes, he should be there. I think it started today, yes.
He must be near the end of the road, would you think?
End of the road?
Yeah. Well, you can't have 4 knee operations and have that kind of thing happening to your bone structure and still be competitive on a world scale.
No, you can't, but still, like the man said, life wasn't meant to be easy. No, not just trying to be funny, but he's had this knee done again, and he's in there trying, and I just sincerely hope that it does stand up to the pressure of tournaments, and we'll just have to wait and see.
Well, determination is one of the keynotes of his outstanding career, and of course he's been exemplary on this stage not so long ago. It seems like yesteryear he was saying, well, I've got to work harder. Yeah. Well, he applied himself, and he did, and look what he's done.
That's right.
Proud father. Well done,
yes,
Alan.
Yes, I am. Thanks
and well done
much.
To Chris. Okay. The Celtics and News Sports Star of the Year continues at the Adelaide Hilton. What a year and what a start to the new one in Auckland. The student teacher who during our year hurled the hammer 76.32 to set a new national record. Now is the gold medalist, Sean Carlin. Sean then set his sights on the Commonwealth record held by the then Commonwealth champion Martin Girvan of Northern Ireland and ended up with the gold medal. Well, look at that. That's what you call release. Mum and Dad were over there to see your game's triumph, but Mary Ann told me she had to stay at home and look after the cats and dogs.
Yeah, well, we've got a new dog there and Mum treats it like a child, and so someone had to stay home and look after it.
How did you go from the triple jump to hammer throwing? That interests me.
Well, I grew, and I think the track at Kensington couldn't take my weight anymore, so they told me to give it up and take up something else.
75.66, a Commonwealth Games record.
Yes, that was quite an interesting competition. I was a bit nervous after the second round.
Winding up.
But luckily, I got it all together in the last round.
He can do it, but he...
There it goes.
Let it go!
And he's done it.
However, stuff from Sean Carlin.
Yes. Nonetheless, it's not all triumph because, you know, you missed out just by 54 centimetres in making the team for Seoul.
Yeah, well, that was a difficult year. I think I threw quite well, but the Australian Union put their qualifying standard up to 75 metres, which was 3 metres higher than international qualifying. And so I was a bit short of the Australian qualifying, so I
God, that's a bit rough.
Home.
Was the surprise dinner party last night a bit of a buzz?
It was fantastic. I was taken quite by surprise. I was expecting a quiet night and I locked up with about 80 people there. It was fantastic.
The phys ed teacher and the Commonwealth Games gold medalist in the hammer throw, Sean Carlin. Winners of the Caltex News Gold are here in force tonight for our anniversary celebration, including the only soccer player to win, the most talked about champion of the game, John Cosmina. John, the international arena, how do you feel about it? And I take into account our 3-0 win against Moscow.
Well, our senior national team's perform incredibly game by game, year by year. Our biggest problem, I guess, is that it's so difficult for us to qualify for the World Cup finals because of the way that FIFA have structured our qualifying rounds. Not only do we have to beat teams like Israel and New Zealand in our local territory, but then we have to play teams like Scotland or South American teams, and it just makes it a little bit too difficult because they're professionals and we're not.
How good to see you again as a Caltechs winner and here on this special 25th anniversary. Thank you, John. All the stars remain. We'll be back with you for the Caltechs News Sports Star of the Year. For the Caltex News Sports Star of the Year so far, 8 of them have been presented. Represented by David Hooks, a teenage cricketer who, like David, became an instant hero when he steered South Australia to a first innings win over New South Wales in the Shield match at Adelaide Oval. Darren Lehman. Darren was dismissed after racking up a magnificent score of 228 runs. South Australia had achieved the seemingly impossible task of overhauling the New South Wales total of 516. Darren was at the crease for 449 minutes, faced 318 balls and hit 28 fours. Must have brought back a few memories.
I didn't see more memories, but he played very well, Tony. He's an outstanding player with a lot of ability, and I think he'll go very well in the next 10 or 15 years.
And you partnered him for quite a lot of those runs in the knock we're talking about.
I played the normal Dow myself and stuck at one end and let Darren do all the work.
You are genuinely impressed with him?
Yes, he's quite outstanding. He's got a lot more maturity than what you see in the footage. You see him facing a cricket ball and playing a shot, but his maturity goes off the ground in net practice and in his ability to understand the game and play it accordingly, and I think that's his greatest attribute.
Other than yourself, who was the last of that potential you've seen here?
Well, he's the best that I've seen in 15 years as a teenager. I guess in runs scored, you'd have to go back to somebody like Doug Walters, that period of play. But certainly in the last 15 years, he's the only teenager, Tony, who can make runs as consistently as he does. And when you consider his club record as well, which I think is something like 600 or 700 plus a double hundred, and he's still at, well, he turned 20 yesterday.
And now he has his chance.
Well, he has. He's sniffing around at the moment as 12th man, and his naivety and his... His wonderful approach to the game was exaggerated this morning when I rang him up in the rooms to see how he was going, and I said, oh, how are you going, Darren? He said, I'm 12th man. as though nobody else in the country knew that he was 12th man. I mean, it was a marvellous touch to how he approaches the game.
David Hooks for Darren Lehman. Thanks, Hooksy.
Thanks, Tony.
In the 1989 Quest, the sensational powerlifter who continues to rewrite her sports history books, Heidi Witesz. Number one in the world, and on no less than four occasions, Heidi was named 1989 International Female Powerlifter of the Year for retaining her world champion crown and setting one world, three Commonwealth, three Australian, and six state records. And 218 kilograms, is that still your best individual lift?
Well, that is my best in the one lift, the squat, but the heaviest weight I've lifted in competition is in another lift, the deadlift, where I've done 227.5 kilos, which is the 501 pounds. It's something I've always wanted to do.
Well, fantastic. And of course, there's an overall of 562 kilos. Express that in layman's terms.
Well, that's the total of the three lifts we do. And I guess, what, 500 kilos is half a ton, but that's not that much.
Not much, it's not. Do any of the Bev Francis records remain?
There are a few. I did break some of hers in 88, which have been broken by a black Dutch girl now in 1989. But she does hold one or two, I think, in a heavy division. But I think they're going to go soon too.
Yeah. I think you've been in every sports star final for 10 years now. It's quite a remarkable record. Are you enjoying your retirement? And presuming that you are, what are you wanting to do?
Well, I have retired from powerlifting as of the last World Championships in November, and I've been doing a bit of conditioning and sort of getting over Christmas and having a good time. And I have been training, but I haven't set any goals, and I'm finding training doesn't have a purpose anymore, and you tend to slack off. And I would like to have a goal. I might do some bodybuilding, but At the moment, I don't really want to compete. I just want to enjoy what I'm doing.
Doing nothing damaging for a figure, is it? Heidi Wittesch, thank you and congratulations once more. It's been a fantastic career. An acknowledgement of that marvellous cyclist, Olympic Games pursuit winner and one of the joint winners of the 1984 Caltex, Mike Turter. Good evening, Mike. Commentator now and just back from the Auckland Games. Niewin, will he ride to victory in the gold, in other words, in Barcelona?
Well, everything we see at the moment's natural, so if we can get him to train, he could do anything.
You weren't like that on the track, were you?
No, I'm a pursuer, not a sprinter.
Yeah, well, I know that. But, I mean, did you train?
Oh, yeah, we trained, and most of the sprinters were in bed when we were out on the road, so...
What about these young fellas that we've got coming on? Are you impressed by them?
Well, you know, a lot of people disappointed with the performance in Auckland, but far from it. Come Barcelona, Australia will show where they stand in the world.
Mike Turter, one of the sports stars of the year, gathered here for our special celebration. Represented by Dennis Hacking, that ultra-marathoner who took line honours in the Sydney to Melbourne Super Endurance race, David Standeven. David crossed the finish line more than 30 minutes ahead of Greek champion Yannis Kouras, who won the event outright. And pretty dramatic at the finish there, wasn't it? He received medical treatment and they put him on a drip for a while.
He certainly did, yes. Yeah.
What ill effects from that experience?
I think David was so fit that the next day he was quite all right. He's a very fit man.
Well, he would need to be, but do runners lose their sense of reason? Do they become incoherent in those circumstances?
He got the wobbles about the third day in, and he went through that barrier like he always does, so he's a pretty strong boy.
Within the race, what was his longest non-stop, if you could tell me that, and longest time without sleep?
We ran him for the first 36 hours. He covered around about 257 kilometres, and then we gave him 90 minutes sleep.
What's he doing? Why isn't he here? Probably sleeping.
Now, at the moment, he's running a 24-hour race in London, and by all accounts, I think he'd done around about 200k, and which is not too good for him. He normally does another 50 or 60k on top of that, so he'd be disappointed.
Will he run the Sydney to Melbourne again?
He won't run it this year. He's going to go into the Great Wall of China race. That's running the Great Wall of China. It's around about 600 kilometres. He'll be running 70k a day, and on the last day he'll run a 100 kilometre race. So all in all, he's pretty fit.
Dennis Hacking for David Standeven. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the 12 for 1989 consideration are accounted for and represent a great variance in sports, with athletics and cricket having two representatives each. I thank our guest of honour, Ian Chappell, and invite him along with you to witness the declaration of the winner of the great award. That will happen soon, and the declaration will come from the Premier. And Ian, that was good.
Thank you very much. I can when you have dark hair too.
So can I. Ian Chappell will be back to announce the winner of the Caltex News Sports Star of the Year.
The News Caltex Sports Star of the Year for 1981 is Vicky Hoffman.
I'd like to thank the News Caltex people who did the judging for showing faith in my sporting ability.
Vicky Cardwell, a triple winner. Well, the final furlong in the 25th anniversary Sports Star of the Year. Who wins it? Well, David Capel knows, and he hands the decision of his expert panel to the Premier. To make the big announcement, ladies and gentlemen, the Premier of South Australia, John Bannon.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Tony, to you, Lord Mayor. I
ministerial and parliamentary colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be here again for the Sports Star of the Year Award. It's something we all look forward to. An amazing panoply of sporting stars appear before us. It's a great way of remembering just what range of talents and skills and dedication we have in this field in South Australia. I might say incidentally in this context that the Sports Star of the Year Award is a very important way of recognising the achievements of our South Australian sports people, but we believe that we ought to be able to do that in a more permanent and longer term way as well. And it's for that reason that the government has been working on this proposition for what was originally called the Sports Hall of Fame. Now, the news, Caltex and others have certainly picked up this idea. We've actually got together a special task force. One of the first things they've decided is that Hall of Fame's a bit old hat, a bit old-fashioned for the name of the sort of thing we want, and we're going to try and find a new dynamic title. No one's come up with one yet, so I invite anybody to make their suggestions. But the idea will be to have a permanent museum of sports and sports recognition in South Australia. And gee, there's going to be an amazing range of sporting heroes that we'll be recognising in that time. Already, of course, 1990 promises to be one of the great Caltex Sports Star of the Year Award series. When we assemble here next year, we've got for a start, just in January, February alone, all of those great Commonwealth Games performers who will no doubt get their recognition, and who knows what the rest of the year will bring. In the meantime, we're looking at 1989, and without more ado, let me announce that the winner of the News Caltex Sports Star of the Year for 1989 is Chris Dittmar.
And Chris's father, Alan Dittmar, comes forward, and for the second time in the great Caltex series, his son has won the cherished prize. Well, how do you feel about
Thank
that?
You. I'm very pleased. Yeah, very proud.
The competition was pretty tough.
It was, yeah, very tough. Yeah.
How do you think he'd feel about it?
Oh, he'd be chuffed out of his mind. It's really, yeah, it's really good. I did say before, you know, like life wasn't meant to be easy. Now Mr. Bannon's here, I'll have to say, you know, it's time. Yeah. No, lovely.
Well, if you think really he's good. Chuffed out of his mind, I think we can do better than that and find out direct, because we have him hooked up on satellite. He's in Canada somewhere. Hello there, Chris Dittmar, Caltex Sports Star of the Year winner. How are you?
Yeah, very good, thanks, Tony.
We're going to give you an ovation to let you know that this is for real.
Thanks very much. It's great to have the opportunity to be able to speak to you anyway. Thanks very much.
I had the temerity to suggest to Dad that you must be getting near the end of the line. We didn't like hearing that you'd had 100 pieces of bone fragment taken out of your knee at the last go.
Yeah, well, I guess that'll give me a few more years, hopefully. I must admit that a month or two back, there was a little bit of doubt, but I really feel fine at the moment. And my first major tournament gets underway today here in Toronto, and I really feel great. So, and this news is an added bonus and makes me feel even better, so there's definitely no problems.
Well, I'm sure the Premier would like to compliment you further, and here he is.
Yes, Chris, on behalf of us all here assembled, I'd like to congratulate you. It was a pretty tough field that you were up against in this 1989 News Caltex Sports Star of the Year Award. But I think there was tremendous acclaim with your victory. You've really done amazing things with your squash. And let's see you kicking on even further. It's a tough game. It's hard to get to the top, much less stay there. And you've brought tremendous distinction on all of us. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
There's a nice testimonial. Chris, and here's Dad to say hello to his boy.
Hi, Chris. How are you?
Hi, yeah, very good, thanks, yeah.
Good.
That's pretty convivial stuff, is that what he's like?
Oh, yeah, no, he's not like that.
That's, man, a few words.
I just want to say thanks very much. Your mother and I are very proud of you and hope everything goes all right for you.
Well, thank you. Thanks very much, obviously, for your support too. I must say that my parents, obviously, years ago gave me the opportunity to pursue a career in sport, and I've been very, very fortunate. Obviously, squash has been very good to me. And if I could take this opportunity now to thank the News and Caltex, this award really does mean a lot to me. And this is, as everyone knows, the 25th anniversary, and for the support that they've given to South Australian sport over those years, and given people such as myself and the other 11 finalists tonight who are to be congratulated, have given us the incentive, I think, over those years to try and achieve greater heights. So I'd like to thank sincerely Caltex and the News for making this award possible.
We're going to say goodnight to you, young fellow, with our congratulations from all the brothers, sisters, nieces and nephews. They're all behind you. So are we in this room tonight. It's quite an electric occasion. Thank you for stimulating it further. And so you know now, as we do, that the candidates were considered, votes were duly cast, and a decision on the best was forthcoming, and on the judgment of the experts, the professionals in sport, the 25th anniversary Caltex and News Sports Star of the Year, and for the second time is the squash champion, Chris Dittmar.
Tonight's telecast of the 1989 Sports Star of the Year Awards was proudly brought to you by Caltex Oil Australia.